Workers could potentially be shifted and rehabilitated into more productive PSCs with training and reskilling efforts. This would bring huge resources into the ambit of the national exchequer and raise productivity of units that are currently stagnant due to various circumstances. The private sector has worked closely with the PSCs as consumers and suppliers, and they enjoy a symbiotic relationship. This relationship has been of benefit to both sides, and private sector looks forward to partnering with the PSCs on a level playing field in building the new manufacturing and infrastructure facilities as required by the nation. It is important to maintain the right balance of public and private sectors in a manner that allows both to function within a fair and inclusive ecosystem. We hope that this summit, bringing together diverse initiatives and ideas in the development of government-led enterprises, both from overseas and locally, would spark a fresh look at the various recommendations and would help in increasing new partnerships. I wish all of you a fruitful 2 days of deliberations. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. Honorable President of India, Shri Pranab Mukherjee, Honorable Minister of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises, Shri Praful Patel, Excellencies, Honorable Guests from abroad, Representative of Overseas State-Owned Enterprises, Shri B.P. Rao, Shri S. Gopal Krishnan, Shri Chandrajit Banerjee, Mr. Narayan Rao, representatives of media, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank you, CII, for setting up this Global PSC Summit, which may go a long way in strengthening the adaptability of state-owned enterprises the world over according to the business environment evolving. In fact, one of the biggest changes we have seen in the world since 2008 financial crisis can be summed up in one sentence. Security is no longer the primary driver of geopolitical developments, economics is. With this in mind, governments have realized that profitable state-owned enterprises make the state stronger. Thus, even if large state-owned enterprises are supposed to have a double bottom line in which social and political objectives are important, profitability has become a key goal. In this context, one can easily discern that the state support, disciplined by the market, gives huge advantages to bolster efficiency and profitability of the enterprises. They derive freedom to invest for long-term rather than short-term profits. It has also emerged that they smooth the economic cycle. Countries with large SOE sectors, such as China, were much faster to cope with the consequences of the financial crisis than liberal capitalist countries. This phenomena has brought global interest in learning more about state-owned enterprise sector. However, paucity of comparable data set is a big constraint. One research paper on global SOEs point out that more than 10% of the world's largest firms, the so-called Forbes Global 2000, are state-owned, and their combined sales equal to $3.6 trillion or 6% of world GDP in 2011. This does not include unlisted SOEs, like in India, out of 279, only 46 are listed. The top five countries with dominance of SOEs in terms of equally weighted average of shares of state-owned enterprises in sales, assets, and market value of the countries, top 10 firms are China with 96%, UAE with 88%, Russia 81%, Indonesia 69%, and Malaysia 68%. India stands seventh with 59% after Saudi Arabia at 67%. Western economies, after this crisis, have shown some green shoots of recovery but are still far away from a satisfactory growth trajectory. Their obsession with pro-cyclic policies influencing the developing economies through the multilateral lending institutions established the proposition beyond any doubt that to continue growing and to minimize the adverse effect of economic cycles, developing economies would do well to have a vibrant, autonomous, and accountable state-owned enterprise sector. However, it cannot be overemphasized that continuous reform to align SOE governance to emerging global best practices is a great contributor to their growth and bottom lines. Even now, opportunities of harnessing synergies between public and private sector could be capitalized for overall global prosperity. In India, Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises being nodal to lay down various systems of SOE governance, it has been our endeavor under the able leadership of Honorable Shri Praful Patel, Minister, to continuously revisit these systems and guidelines, review and reform, so as to facilitate the state-owned enterprises not only to cope with the ever-changing global business environment effectively, but also thrive and deliver in terms of surpluses, employment, and overall welfare of society. The state is a powerful support for the economy of developing countries, but too powerful a state, not knowing when to loosen its hold and when to withdraw fully, can be as harmful as an ultra-minimal state. Most of the developing countries, including, of course, us, have not been able to do enough in this direction, and therefore, our priority is to formulate efficient, effective systems for enhancing autonomy on one hand for SOEs and on the other to provide for a smooth exit. That is to withdraw fully from sectors where others are delivering competitively or SOEs are not able to sustain profitably. Although we have a board for reconstruction of public enterprises to examine cases of sick SOEs, the priority has been to turn them around by providing rehabilitation packages. Whereas creative destruction of firms is one of the key strengths of free market and liberalist economic policies. And it's not a bad idea if it is painless to the disadvantaged. Therefore, state-owned enterprise governance should aim at improving such painless exit routes to redeploy labor and capital from such SOEs to emerging potential domains. To conclude, I would like to emphasize that in this globalized world, transparency, ethical business practices, equity and equality in distribution of incomes, respect to universal human rights, not only in state-owned enterprises, businesses, but also all along their supply chains, and above all, ensuring every employee contributes to social and environmental sustainability will hold the key to success. I wish this global summit all success. Thank you.
Secretary Public Enterprises, Shri O.P. Rawat, President of CII, Shri Gopal Krishnan, Chairman of BHEL, Shri B.P. Rao, Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, Mr. Narayan Rao, distinguished guests this morning, participants from overseas, friends, ladies and gentlemen. I am indeed very honored to be speaking here this morning in the presence of our respected Rashtrapati ji, who has come this morning to inaugurate this global summit of PSEs organized jointly by CII and the Department of Public Enterprises. Friends, in India, public sector has a special significance, and I think one of the most important steps which post-independence India took, the government took, was to lay a strong foundation for industrialization, and that was done through the public sector. And even after so many years, more than 66 years from the time we got independent, the public sector has still a very, very important and a dominant position in the overall industrialization and the economic development of our country. And I'm very happy that while public sector has progressed immensely over the years, the private sector also has now come in, and hand in hand, both the public sector and the private sector are contributing to nation building and to the economic development of our country. When we talk of public sector, of course, there is a very strong emotional connect with the people, as the public sector has truly been touching many lives across the country. There are many places, many instances which we can give, and Honorable Rashtrapati ji is aware. Many parts of India would still have remained underdeveloped had it not been for the strong presence of the public sector. Public sector set up units, industries in places far and remote, where otherwise normally private enterprise would not have ventured to go. Things are very different after 66 years. But if you look at the 50s, 60s, 70s, when infrastructure, communication, and other facilities were lacking in our country, it was truly the public sector which went. And I can give many examples. You would not have seen Bokaro or Rourkela or Bhilai or in Assam or in Haldia or many other places development taken place had it not been for the strong role of the public sector. And I'm very happy that public sector also has now begun to evolve and to be contemporary, to try to meet the aspirations of the people and also to meet the challenges of global competition. We are no more insulated from the outside world, whether it be public sector or private sector. We are truly living in an era of globalization and economic liberalization. And to that effect, it is important that the public sector is also able to proceed and work with the same, nimble-footedness and with the same kind of flexibility as private sector is able to do. And that is why over the years, the government has brought in the concept of grading these public sector to be giving them more operational and financial flexibility. We have now the Mini Ratnas, we have the Navratna companies, we have the Maharatna companies. These are all steps in that direction to be able to give operational flexibility. Today, a Maharatna company has the ability to take decisions at the board level of up to 5,000 crores of rupees, which would not have been possible. And I think over the years, we will look at further trying to make more easier norms so that the public sector can operate with even further flexibility. We have in the recent past appointed a committee, and that committee's recommendations have been referred to a group of ministers, which in turn has now finalized its recommendations to be now approved by the cabinet in due course. And I would say that it would be in the course of the next few weeks that this recommendations of the group of ministers will be put up. And I'm sure these recommendations are based on a committee which was set up specially with the public sector in mind, and the public sector former chief was heading it, interacted with a lot of public sector heads, and how to find ways and means to be able to give this kind of flexibility and operational freedom. And I think the government is very committed, will make sure that these recommendations are adopted at the earliest, and this will pave the way for a further impetus to the public sector. I would also like to say that while a lot of talk does take place very randomly, very loosely, that public sector is not well managed. But I can assure you that if you look at the performance of many a public sector, not only the Maharatnas, but even the Navratna companies, even some Mini Ratna companies, their performance is absolutely on par or even better than some of the best-run private sector companies. And even sectorally, if you look at it, in some sectors where we feel that the private sector has done exceedingly well, you will not find a public sector lacking anywhere in its operations or in its performance, even financial parameters, than that of the private sector. So we have to acknowledge the fact today, as has been pointed out by the Secretary, all public sector is not listed. In fact, I would very candid to say that the valuation in the stock market of a public sector company is far, far lower than the valuation which a private sector company derives. And that is, I think, it's just a perceptional outlook, whereas absolutely in real terms, in asset base and in all other parameters, a public sector company should probably be more valuable than its counterpart in the private sector. And I can give you an example, a loose example of, sir, say, Steel Authority of India vis-a-vis its counterparts in the private sector. And it would certainly attract a much higher valuation if the outlook or the perception of the investors would be probably much more broad-based and much more liberal. And therefore, company after company can certainly derive a much higher valuation. Sir, out of the 260-odd public sector in the country, the perception is that public sector is underperforming or makes big losses. Only 66 PSEs are in the SIC category, out of which, under a revival package under the Board of Reconstruction of Public Sector Enterprises, 43 of the 66 have already been approved for revival. And I'm happy to say that out of these 43, 24 have already posted profits and 13 have already turned around. So to say that public sector by far is a loss-making entity or underperforming is something of a misnomer, and I think that perception also needs to be corrected in due course of time. So I would not like to go into too much of detail except the fact that this is a summit where private sector, the CII, as well as the public sector, and people from here and from outside the country are coming together to share and exchange their views, their thoughts, and to see that what are the best practices which are being followed by public sector enterprises outside of India also. And maybe even our practices may also be some of the finest in the industry, which even companies from outside of India would like to adopt. So I think this interaction, this exchange of views at an international level for public sector enterprises to come together, talk to each other, engage with each other, and to adopt the best practices is something truly commendable. And I think CII and the Department of Public Enterprises have done exceedingly well in trying to organize the summit. And I'm more honored and very happy to say that none other than our most respected President of India has himself come here. Itself shows the importance which Government of India attaches to the role of public sector in the overall development of our great nation. So thank you very much for organizing this summit, and I would be especially thanking Honorable Rashtrapati Ji for having come this morning to grace this occasion and to shower his love and affection towards the public sector. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Good morning to all of you. Sri Praful Patel, Union Minister of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises. Sri S. Gopal Krishnan, President, Confederation of Indian Industry. Sri O.P. Rawat, Secretary to the Department of Public Enterprises. Sri B.P. Rao, Chairman, CII Council on Public Sector Enterprises, and CMD, Bharat Heavy Electrical Limited. M. Narayan Rao, Chairman, Steering Committee for CII, Global PSE Summit, and Chairman and Managing Director, Mishra Dhatu Nigam Limited. Chandrajit Banerjee, Director General, Confederation of Indian Industry. It's my pleasure to be amidst you this evening to inaugurate the Global PSE Summit organized by Department of Public Enterprises and the Confederation of Indian Industry. It is an occasion to appreciate the valuable partnership provided by the public sector in India's development journey. It is also a forum to reiterate our commitment to strengthen the public sector. Ladies and gentlemen, public sector has played a stellar role in Indian economy after independence. The Constitution of India has guided our